Good morning and welcome to MCC Online. This has been our new home for the past 6 weeks as we've not been able to meet in person. So we are reaching out to you via your phone or your tablet or your TV. And I hope that the adjustments we've made over time is really helping you to feel more comfortable in this worship setting. So again, good morning and welcome to MCC Online.
Oh, I need you every Helpless and rusty, your grace is born. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you.
So teach my song to rise to you. Comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. 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 Darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
There's an endless song echoes in my soul. I hear the music ringing. And though the storms may come, I am holding on to the rock I cling. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart want to sing. I will lift my eyes in the darkest night, for I know my Savior lives. And I will walk with you, knowing you'll see me through, and sing the songs you give. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart want to sing. Troubled times, sing when I win. I can sing when I lose my step and I fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up. Sing 'cause you're there. I can sing 'cause you hear me, Lord, when I call to you in prayer. I can sing with my last, for I know that I'll sing with the angels and the saints around the throne. How can I keep from singing your praise? How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart. I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart. I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart want to sing. I can see.
John 1:14-17. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks before me, because he was before me.' For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ."
We are in week 3 of a teaching series called Can You Hear Me Now? We're talking about exploring the idea of hearing the voice of God as he speaks to us, directs us, and leads us into our life's purpose. And so we're exploring the idea of how does God speak and what does that sound like? What does that look like? So message 1 and message 2 were introductory to the 7 different voices that God uses to speak. So this week is the first of those 7, and that is entitled Continue to Abide. It comes from John chapter 1, verses 14-17 that Addison just read for us. So whether we realize it or not, we all have a starting point, a place from which we view our lives. The starting point establishes maybe a moral baseline or a starting point, so to speak, helping us to differentiate between right and wrong in the world. It's how we view the world and how we decide what is moral, what is immoral, what is right, what is wrong. Now, this baseline creates the lens in which we view everything, every situation, every interaction, every person, every decision. Now, for some, this standard fluctuates and it becomes situational. And depending on the situation, depends on how they view certain things. For other people, this is fixed. And no matter what the situation, their viewpoint and their baseline is always going to be the same. That being said, I want you to understand that some of us view life through the lens of childhood abuse. Or others view life from the perspective of maybe a blended family. Your parents were divorced and got remarried, and so you had two sets of parents growing up. Or maybe still others view life from the lens of wealth. They had lots of money, and they never had need growing up. They had whatever they wanted, whatever they needed. Or maybe the opposite. You view life through the lens of poverty. You had nothing growing up, and you were as poor could be. Maybe it's through a lens of race. You're a certain race, and because of that, there are some things that come along with that, so that's how you view life. Or maybe it's a nationality. You're from a different nation or a different nation group or people group. And then still others view life through a whole other set of lenses, right? We don't all come to this from the same point of view, from the same perspective, and from the same past. We look at things through our own and from our own vantage point, from where we are standing. Now, the latest minds in the world call this a worldview. How do you view the world? Since my salvation at age 16, I was taught and believed that the Bible was a final authority for my life. And because of that, I would pour into reading the Word of God and studying the Word of God, memorizing Scripture. I went off to Bible college and took Bible class after Bible class after Bible class after Bible class. I've taught from the Bible for 20 plus years, so I have a real working knowledge of the Bible. Now, not as much as I would like it to be, but much larger than most. So because of that, the vantage point that I have is filtered through the Bible, because the Bible is my baseline. It's my bedrock. It is the solid ground upon which I've built most of my life. So I view almost all situations and all circumstances through the filter of the Word of God. It's where I draw my wisdom, my knowledge, my courage, my faith, my absolutes. Now, don't get me wrong. Just because I know a lot of Scripture and because I filter things through Scripture and I ask the question, what does the Bible say, doesn't mean I get it right all the time. It doesn't mean that my way is perfect or that I am the model for anyone. I'm just saying that while all of us come to decisions and circumstances with our own point of view, mine tends to be, what does the Bible say? Or where in the Bible does this come from? And how can I balance this with the Word of God? I believe the Bible is the inspired Word of God. And by that I mean that God inspired every one of these words. He spoke into the heart and ear of man, and man, hearing his voice, wrote down what he said. Inspired by God. 2 Timothy, I think it is, 3:16 says that it is God-breathed. It's as if God were standing behind them, over their shoulder, and speaking, whispering into their ear the words that they would write. So because I believe the Bible is inspired by God, then I treat it as a final authority in all the matters of my faith and belief. If the Bible is the Word of God, then I give to it great authority and weight in my life. I also believe that the Bible is an absolute in this world, that it is steady, that it is faithful, that it is sturdy, that it is absolute. When all the other world is shifting and moving and unstable, I believe the Bible to be absolutely concrete and stable. Because of that, I believe the Bible is the truth above all opinions. The world demands tolerance. For about a decade now, that has been a buzzword that is tossed around more times than I care to admit. And people speak of tolerance, and they cry out for tolerance, and they demand tolerance. And what they're really doing is they're thinking that it's best for everyone involved if we were just more tolerant of each other, and that we wouldn't call things right or wrong, that we would just have a tolerance for other people's point of views. And so what's happened over many, many years now is the truth gets sacrificed on the altar of tolerance. Because you can't say you're tolerant of someone if you say their viewpoint is wrong. And so instead of telling others their viewpoint is wrong based on absolute truth, we cry for tolerance. And so what happens is our nation and world becomes devoid of truth. And because it's void of truth, it will not last and it will not stand. Well, God calls us to a higher standard than tolerance. He calls us to truth. He expects us and demands of us, commands us to live in truth. Truth gets a bad rap sometimes, though, because people shrink back from it. People shrink back from truth because truth has been used to bully people, and the truth has been used to hurt people, and the truth has been used and applied and delivered in a way that has been very harmful. And so people shrink back, which is why we live in a world that cries out tolerance, tolerance, tolerance. People have been beat over the head with truth. They've been banished from their families because of truth. They've been judged harshly and excluded because of truth. So it makes perfect sense why so many people throw truth out and why tolerance has been adopted. But I want to say that that is not the way of truth from the Bible. That's not the way of truth from the Bible. Biblical truth is almost always partnered with or coupled with grace. Grace. I want to read those verses to you again in John 1, 14, 16, and 17. It says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen His glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." Verse 16, "For from His fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ." Right? Grace upon grace. And grace and truth came through our Lord Jesus Christ. So let me give you a really rudimentary definition of the word truth. Truth means I will be honest with you no matter what. I'll be honest with you no matter what. If you ask me if this pair of pants makes your butt look big, I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm going to be honest with you no matter what. But let me give you a definition of grace. Grace means I'm going to love you no matter what. Even if your butt looks big in those pants, I'm going to love you, right? That's a very crass way, I suppose, of defining these. I hope you forgive me. Truth means I will be honest with you no matter what. Grace means I will love you no matter what. So if that's the understanding, that truth is always partnered with or always coupled with grace, if truth is always being honest, and grace is always loving. So if we're always loving with our honesty, then the Bible is truth, but it is not a weapon to be used against someone. If it's absolute truth, but it's coupled with absolute love, we don't use this to hurt people. We use it to help. So, if the Bible and its truth isn't a weapon to beat people over the head, then the flip side to that is, to think everybody's right and nobody's wrong is silly. Right? It's detrimental to the well-being of everyone. Yes, the Bible is truth, and so therefore we have to apply truth. And if there's truth, then that means there must be something that is false. There absolutely are things in this world that are not right. And so tolerance says that we just have to live with that, and everybody gets to have their own opinion, and no one is right, no one is wrong. We're just existing. The Bible is very clear that there is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end leads to destruction. There's a right and there's a wrong. Jesus Christ said of himself, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man shall come to the Father but by me. He declared that there is a right way to God, therefore leaving wrong ways to God. And so the Bible is not a bully. It's not something that we hurt other people with, or we hit people over the head with, or that we try to tear down people with, but it is absolutely a truth, a stone, a boulder, a steady, faithful place where we can find right and we can find what is wrong. I think this is vital to the world. There has to be honesty and truth in relationships. There has to be honesty between husband and wife. If something wrong is happening, there needs to be a conversation about it. And we know what is wrong based on what we know to be true. There has to be honesty between friends. If you want that friendship to have any merit whatsoever, there has to be honesty. There has to be honesty between a student and a teacher. If the student gets the problem wrong, the teacher needs to be able to tell that student that that is wrong and that this is what is right. There has to be honesty between parent and child. There needs to be honesty between a pastor and his parishioners. But in those same relationships, there also must be grace as well. There must be love no matter what. Even if a spouse is wrong, there must be love. Even if the child is wrong, there must be love. Even if the parishioner is wrong, there must be love. We couple truth with love. A real husband, a real wife, a real friend, a real teacher, a real parent, a real pastor will always speak the truth in love. The Bible is a truth teller. We go to the Word of God, and because of God's love for humanity, He speaks to us truth. His love demands it. You see, the biggest thing we should know about God's Word is that it is living, breathing, and active, and that it tells us the truth while showing us grace. The Bible says grace upon grace upon grace. It's the idea of piling more and more love on top of itself. Grace upon grace. Hebrews 4, 12 through 13 says this about the Word of God. It says, for the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And no creature is hidden from its sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of Him to whom we must give an account. The Bible is alive and active and sharp, and it causes us to give an account. It causes us to be compared to it. We receive an image back from it of ourselves, and we see when we look at the Bible where truth is in us and where falsehood is in us. It exposes us and brings things that are hidden into the light. It speaks truth. It goes to the heart of who we are and what we are doing. So that leads to say this. We don't just read the Bible. The Bible reads us. The Bible reads us. And because of that, then our goal shouldn't be that we just get through the Bible, but that we get the Bible through us, right? Our goal isn't that we should sit down and just try to read through the Bible as much as, or as fast as we can. No, our goal is to sit down and let the Bible get through us. Pour through our veins, pour through our mind, pour through our spirit so that it becomes our worldview. So that we filter every situation, every circumstance, every decision, every thought through the Word of God that is the truth. The Bible is timeless, yet it's relevant. It's not some old book that no longer applies. It is an old book that applies today just as powerfully as it applied 1,000 years ago as it applied 6,000 years ago. It never grows stale. It never empties of new and fresh meanings for our lives. Just a couple of facts about the Bible. One is the Bible was written by more than 40 different writers over the course of 1,500 years in three different languages and on three different continents. The authors range from farmers to fishermen to kings to poets to prophets to prisoners of war. It covers nearly every subject matter under the sun: law, history, poetry, prophecy, cosmology, theology, marriage, and sex, and so much more. Despite it touching on hundreds of controversial topics, never once does it contradict itself. Ancient scribes devoted their entire life to just making one copy of the sacred text. Translators like William Tyndale and John Wycliffe were murdered in order to give us the Bible in English. The Bible, outside of God Himself, is the most powerful thing in the world. The most powerful thing in the world. Yet so many of us take it for granted. We own a dozen copies of it, yet we never take the time to read it. We never take the time to pour ourselves into the study of the Word of God. We assign no value to it, even though we would shake our head and say amen that yes, it is the most powerful thing in the world outside of God Himself. For some, the Bible is just something pretty that they look at, something pretty and nice that they own, like a painting that they put on their wall, but they've walked by it every day for so many days that they don't even notice just how beautiful the painting is anymore. They no longer admire it. They just own it. But the Bible comes alive only when we actively do what the Bible commands us to do. It's not simply just something you look at, and it's not even something you just simply read, but it is something that you do. The Bible is something that you do. It is words that you put into action with your life. So what does that have to do with hearing the voice of God? Well, I would say this. You want to know God? Do you want to hear His voice in your life? Then the very first thing that you have to do, maybe even the most important thing that you should do, is read the Bible and do what it says. Right? For the next weeks, we're going to talk about all the different voices of God and how He speaks to us. But if there's any one that I would put at the top of the list, it is this week, and that is that the Bible is something that you must read and then do what it says. Because why would God speak to you if you're going to choose to be disobedient to the things He's already said to you? Why would God speak again to you if you're already disobedient to the things He's already said and asked? The Bible changes the way we think, the way we feel, the way we live, the way we love, and the way we make our decisions. And so the more we read the Bible, the more we understand the Bible, the more we study the Bible, the more effect it has on us. The Bible changes us. One of the ways it does is, or the way it does that is where I'm going to spend the rest of my time today, and that's found in John 15, verse 7. In that verse, it says this, "If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you." Now, John chapter 15 is a wonderful chapter. It's one of my favorites, probably in the top three favorite chapters of all the Bible. And it's because of this word abide. You see, in John chapter 15, the word abide is repeated 11 times. But then if you go to 1 John chapters 1 through 5, it's repeated 20 more times. So John 15 or John 1:5, it's repeated 11 times. In 1 John chapters 1 through 5, it's repeated 20 times, this word abide. Now the word abide is what's called a present imperative verb. Now, I was never an English person. I hated English. In fact, I missed so many English classes my senior year that it's a surprise that I'm a writer or a speaker at all. So maybe you're in the same boat, and present imperative verb doesn't mean much to you. It's just a really big way of saying that it indicates a continuous action. Abide is not something that you do or have done. It's something that you were to continue to be doing. So Jesus is saying, continually abide. Continually abide in him, and let his words continually abide in you. It's this idea of every day coming back to his word and spending time there. It's every day allowing his word to spend time in you, right? Not just read it, walk away from it, and forget everything that you saw, but read it, think through it, meditate on it, pray about it, and as you walk away, carry it with you and allow it to simmer in your heart throughout the day. Now, abide is one of those million-dollar words. It's simple, right? We hear it and we think, oh, I know exactly what that means. Yet when we get into the scripture and we start to read and see all of the times that it shows up, it creates some context where maybe this word is a little bit more, a little bit deeper, a little bit bigger than we originally thought. Some simple definitions is, one, to be moved by. We don't always think of that word that way, but that is definitely one of the contextual definitions of this word in how it's used in some places. We're to be moved by. It means to stand still, and that's how most of us see it. If we're abiding somewhere, it means we're staying there. It has a deeper meaning of to stay overnight, not just to stay for a time, but to stay overnight, to spend a night with it. And then, of course, the word to dwell. Now, think through those four definitions with me for just a moment. We are allow Jesus' words to abide in us or to move us, right? To move us into actions. So if we abide in his word and his word abides in us, then his word moves us to action. We're to stand still on his words, right? We are to stand on the word of God. We are to make it our bedrock, our worldview, and we are not to be moved off of that rock. So we are to stand on his words. We're to stay overnight in his word. Spend some real time there. It's not just reading your chapter for the day so you can mark off your list or your three chapters or reading this one book. No, it's to spend some extended hours with the word of God. And for some of you, that's maybe multiple chapters or multiple books. But for some of you, that might just be three verses. And the Lord is just wrestling with you over these three verses. And you spend the night wrestling with God in those three verses. You're abiding with him, and his word is abiding with you. And we are to dwell. We are to linger. We're to stay a little longer. We're not to just run past it. We're to kind of linger there for a moment. What is it saying? What does it mean? Who is he speaking to? How does this apply to my life? Dwell with what you're reading so that you can garner a better understanding. If you truly want to hear the voice of God, then we have got to do more than simply read the pages of the Bible. We've got to abide there. to remain in them for periods of time, to slow down, to read over the same passage many times until you really have an understanding of what God is saying to you through the Word of God. Pray over what you've read. Ask God to illuminate, to shed light on this scripture that seems dark to you, that you don't fully understand. But it also means that you have to be intentional about what you read. Mark Batterson, in his book Whisper, talks about the flip and point approach. People talk about, well, I just flip open the Word of God and I point it and then that's what I read. He said one guy was doing that and he cautioned against anyone else doing that. He said because this guy, he was looking for a little inspiration, so he took his Bible and he just kind of flipped open the pages and he pointed to a passage, and the passage that he pointed to said this: Judas went away and hanged himself. And the guy said to himself, well, that wasn't inspirational at all. I'm going to try again. So he flipped it open and flipped to a random page and pointed down again, and he read the verse that he was pointing to, and the very next verse that he flipped to said, now go and do likewise. That was not a good approach to get to hear the voice of the Lord. And I would recommend that that's not the best approach for you either. Be very intentional about what you're reading. And it may be that you start in a book and you work your way through that book, or you set out these four chapters and you're going to work your way through these four chapters, but you're not going to stop with these four chapters until you really understand what those chapters are saying to you, or what that book is saying to you, or what that passage is. I recommend you find a reading plan and then follow that plan. But don't be in a rush. You don't have to finish. It's not a race. But you do have to understand, and you do have to let the Bible speak to you. I would recommend that maybe you try to read through the Old Testament in a year, or read through the New Testament in a year. And maybe some of you have a better grasp or understanding on the Word of God. Maybe you can read the whole Bible through in a year. There's all kinds of Bible plans online that will give you what you need to read every day in order to accomplish that. You can even buy a Bible that's called the Bible in a Year that will every day tell you what day of the year you should be reading and keep you on track to be through the Bible in 1 year. But it's this idea of being deliberate and intentional about what you're reading. Coming back and picking up where you left off so the story of the Bible continues in your heart. So you see the connecting points. But I'm sorry to say this. Hearing the voice of God is not as simple as just reading the Bible. It requires us to think about what we're reading. It requires us to pray over what we're reading. And again, it requires us to do something with what we're reading. Peter Marshall said this: I wonder what would happen if we all agreed to read one of the Gospels until we came to a place that told us to go do something. Then we actually went out and did what we were told, and only after we had done it, we began reading again. Man, that's powerful. Sometimes we just read through the Bible and we get to a point where we're being commanded to do something, and we read beyond it just trying to get to the next chapter. And we walk away after having read and forgot what the command was, what it was that we were to practice, or what it was that we were to become. What would happen if we began doing what the Bible told us to do? It would change the world. It would change the world. The Bible is a conduit for the voice of God. God speaks through His Word into our lives. But we cannot hear His voice by simply just skimming through the pages and flipping open and putting our finger down and just reading something to try to find something for today. We have to give it the time that it's due. And we have to get so comfortable with the Word of God that we are freed up to then hear the voice speak from the Word of God that is God's. Remember, why would God speak to someone if He knows that that someone is not going to do what He asks them to do? Why would God speak to you if He already knows that you're going to ignore His voice? So I want to challenge you this week to get your Word of God out. Get your Bible out. Fall in love with it all over again. Ascribe to it the weight and the power and authority that God has given it. Treat it as something that is powerful and sharp and able to reflect to you truth. And they began to be deliberate about reading it again every day, 5 minutes a day, 10 minutes a day, an hour a day, whatever it is that you can do, do it. And give God days and weeks and months to begin speaking to you through one of his most prominent voices, the Word of God. Would you bow your heads? Lord, thank you for the Word of God, that you have protected it for thousands of years so that we have it, that you inspired men to write it, that it doesn't contradict itself, that it is not worn out and no longer applicable, but that it's still alive and it still speaks to the heart of men. God, thank you for the many days and months and years that you've spent with me through your word. Thank you that its message still applies and it still has an effect on your people. Lord, if there's anyone under the sound of my voice today that doesn't have a relationship with you first, I pray that they would give their lives to Jesus Christ, that they would become a child of you, God, through the death, burial, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, that they would become a follower, that they would be secured and given a home in heaven when they die, but then also that we would all begin a new relationship with your word, hoping to hear your voice through what you've already said in your written word, that we would fall in love with the Bible all over again. Thank you for all of the great things that you're doing in the church, across the internet, across all of the different technology, and across this great land this morning. Lord, the world is coming alive to your voice again. Thank you that there's so many churches that are active in giving the good news of Jesus Christ to the world. Thank you for the souls that have been saved. We've heard now the estimate is over 100,000 people have given their life to Jesus Christ since this pandemic started. What a wonderful thing. We are glad that your truth tells us what it is required in order to become your child. And that is, we just place our faith in Jesus Christ and call him Lord. God, as we step into our week, may we do so with our Bibles in our hands, asking you, do it again in me, Lord. Speak to me through your word the way you've spoken to so many. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Separate, even if I ran away, your love never fails. I know I still make mistakes, but you have new mercies for me every day. Your love never fails. Same through the ages, your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. is strong and the waters deep, but I'm not alone here in these open seas.
Your love never fails.
Is far too wide. I never thought I'd reach the other side.
Your love never fails.
You stay the same through the ages.
Your love never changes.
There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in the morning.
When the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid,
because I know that you love me.
Your love never fails.
Morning.
And when the oceans rage, I don't have